opportunity to come and to minister here tonight. But I was just thinking about all the great experiences, just as we were, just as we were worshiping, I was just thinking about all the great experiences just in God that we've had in this place. And it's just a pretty amazing thing to see what God's done over the years. And I was just thinking about, I mean, gosh, we could take all night and just talk about all the good things that have happened. But God is good. He's just so good. And I was just thinking about, on my way here, just as far as, I mean, I knew what I was going to minister tonight, but I'm just thinking about some things that God has done in my life in this place. And I'm so grateful for this place. And I'm so grateful for a pastor that hears from God and follows the leading of the Holy Spirit. It's such a valuable thing to have in your life. And I'm grateful for Pastor Bracken and Donna and their family and for what they've done here and what they've put here and the sacrifices that they've made. You know, I think that's a side of it that we don't always see and don't always appreciate it. It's, you know, we see the outward side of things. We see the effect of what they've put into it, but we don't see the sacrifices that they've made and the seeds that they've sown. And we're grateful for that. Amen. Yes. Praise the Lord. I want to share with you something that God just put on my heart for tonight. If you want to turn with me in your Bibles, go to 1 Timothy chapter 6. And also 1 John chapter 5. 1 Timothy chapter 6. And 1 John chapter 5. In 1 Timothy chapter 6 in verse 12, this is probably a familiar passage, but 1 Timothy chapter 6 in verse 12, it says, "Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses." And, you know, we'll just take this kind of line by line, but he starts with fight the good fight of faith. And how many of you know there's a fight when it comes to faith? Yeah. You have to fight a fight of faith. And the fight that you fight isn't always against the devil. There's times when you come up against evil. There's times when you come up against the work of the enemy in your life. But the fight isn't always against the devil. Sometimes the fight is to stay in the place of faith. Sometimes the fight is to think faith thoughts. Sometimes the fight is just to maintain your attitude and your outlook. And the enemy will come against you in a lot of different ways, and he'll bring fears and wrong thoughts. He'll try to bring discouragement and frustration. He'll try to bring all kinds of things against you. But you have to fight the fight of faith. You have to fight to hold on to those things that God says are yours. You have to fight for the plan and the purpose of God in your life. And so there's a fight. And where your faith is concerned, your faith is going to be challenged. If you haven't discovered that by now, you will. But your faith is going to be challenged. It's not a matter of will it be challenged. It's a matter of when it's going to be challenged. Because your faith is going to be challenged. What you believe, what God says He has for you, is going to be challenged. There's this idea, there's this thought that you hear people say all the time. Christian people, well-meaning people, they say all the time things like, well, you know, God is in control. Well, God is in control. Good things happen, bad things happen. Well, God is in control. The problem that I have with that statement is that they never go any further than that. In control of what? Because God is not in control of everything. Not at this moment, He's not. If he was, it wouldn't be such a mess. Right? I mean, if God was in control of everything, we wouldn't see just the disasters that we see all over the place. Well, God is in control. But is he really? The reality is that God is in control of what you submit to him. God is in control of what you give to him. Where in the places and in the areas where you defer to him, God is in control. But in the places, I mean, when we have things in our lives that we say to God, this is off limits, this is mine, I'm holding on to this, and we're not willing to let God talk to us about those things. We're not willing to let God change anything there. God isn't in control of that. In places where we say we don't want the Word of God, we don't want the Bible, we don't want prayer, we don't want those things, God isn't in control of those things. And he's not in control of the things that flow out of that. Amen. So is God really in control? Well, not everywhere, not all the time. Now, will those things eventually be submitted to God? Will those things eventually have to bow their knee to the lordship of Jesus? Yes, eventually. But right now, that's not necessarily the case, right? You know, in John chapter 10 and verse 10, Jesus said, the thief comes only to steal, to kill, and to destroy. He said, but I am come that you might have life and life more abundantly. Right? I mean, probably a familiar verse. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I am come. He drew a very clear line, a very clear distinction between what the enemy wants to do and what Jesus himself came to do, right? But how many times in people's minds do they associate the things that the enemy is doing or has done with God? They say, well, God did this. You know, it's like the kind of the classic illustration. The insurance company's classifying a tornado, a hurricane, you know, something like that, as an act of God. Well, was it really? No. Because God doesn't steal, kill, and destroy. But people get it all mixed up and confused. But the reality is, you've got two separate and distinct personalities. Two people on either side. You've got the enemy, the devil, and his crowd and his system. You've got Jesus and his kingdom and his system, his ways of doing things on the other side of that. And they each have a distinct, and unique plan for you going forward. Right? Jeremiah 33 says, I have a plan for you. I mean, God was very clear in that. He said, I have a plan for you. Y'all remember that verse? I'm sorry, I said 33. It's Jeremiah 29:11. Jeremiah 29:11. And he said, I know the plans that I have for you. And he said, they're plans for a future and a hope. They're plans for good things. That's God speaking to his people. He said, I have a plan for you. I have a plan for good things, for a future and for a hope. For your welfare, not for calamity. When he said welfare, he wasn't talking about you being on a government program. God can do better for you than the government can. Thank God for that. But plans for your welfare, that you would do well. God has a good plan. He said, I have a good plan. So you've got God working for your good, and you've got the enemy then trying to undermine and just tear down the plan and the purpose of God for your life. Two separate and distinct personalities. They're at war with one another. They're trying to work two completely and incompatible plans and purposes in your life. So which one are you going to have? But see, so many Christians step back. They just step back and they say, well, I mean, God's in control. And really, that phrase, God is in control, has become just sort of a Christian way of just submitting to circumstances. People have just backed up and said, well, I mean, it's a It's a spiritualized way of saying, well, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Well, the Bible tells us what to do. He said, fight the good fight of faith. Fight for what is yours. Because the Bible lays out what belongs to you. Not just forgiveness and salvation and a place in heaven, but a whole life, a whole way of living. The Bible lays out for you. But if you don't know what it says, if you don't know, and sadly, too many times Christians don't know what belongs to them, and so they just, God is in control. What are you going to do? You just take whatever comes. But when you know what God wants for you, when you know what the Bible says is yours, then you can fight for it. And the Bible tells us to do that, to fight the good fight of faith. Fight the good fight of faith. What makes a good fight? Well, we've heard and probably said ourselves, well, it's a fight that you win. That's part of it. But winning, there's more to a good fight than just winning. I mean, if you ever watched boxing or any of the fighting sports, there's some fights when you just go, it was all right, I guess. And then there's some fights you go, wow, what a fight. What makes a good fight? Is it both sides are in it? They're bringing it, right? Fight the good fight of faith. Don't just phone it in. Don't just go through the motions. What makes a good fight? That makes me think of what makes a good fighter. Winning alone doesn't make a good fighter. A good fighter is a good fighter even before he wins. A good fighter doesn't become a good fighter in the ring. A good fighter becomes a good fighter in the gym. A good fighter becomes a good fighter at home, in his habits and in his routine. He gets up in the morning and he does the right things. He goes to the gym and he trains the right way, and he's disciplined. He brings a disciplined approach to it. To fight a good fight of faith, you have to bring a disciplined approach to your life and to your fight. He said, fight the good fight of faith. You have to bring that fighting attitude. You have to bring that desire to not just win it, but to live it. Amen. Because see, a fighter who doesn't love the preparation, who doesn't love the lifestyle, won't last. Amen. They won't last. But he said, fight the good fight of faith. And so fighting the good fight of faith is more than just, well, I'm a Christian and I'm just not going to give up on God. We're going to hold on and not give up on God. It's knowing how to fight and bringing discipline to every part and every aspect of your life. There's a way to fight that really has to be learned. You know, the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, it says, study to show yourselves approved unto God, a workman that needs not be ashamed. You study in order to find out what belongs to you. You study in order to find out what God has said about you, and then you allow the Scripture to inform your life. You allow the Scriptures to inform your beliefs and even speak to your daily routine. Speak to what you do, because without allowing the Bible. Let me just back up a second. What most Christians do, what most people do, is they say, well, I just believe. You know, faith is more than just believing. Well, I just believe. Well, what are you doing with that belief? That belief has to has to touch how you live. It has to touch what you do. It has to affect your mouth. It has to affect your thinking. And people say, well, I just believe. But faith was never designed to be bottled up on the inside of you. Faith bottled up on the inside, you may value it, you may hold it precious, but it won't really work for you the way that it's supposed to, because it wasn't designed to just be bottled up on the inside. Faith demands an expression. Faith demands an expression. And when we do what the Bible says to do, when we speak what the Bible says, then we're giving expression to our faith, and we're holding it's the way that we ensure that we're doing what the Bible says to do. You remember what God told Joshua in Joshua chapter 1? Anybody remember that? God told Joshua, he told him to be strong and very courageous. Now, he told him that because he was facing something that was pretty significant. I mean, what just happened was Moses went for a walk one day and didn't come back. Miracle-working Moses. Moses who stood in the presence of God. Moses whose face shone with the glory of God so brightly that he had to wear a veil. Moses who heard from God and relayed God's word to the people, who brought the people out of Egypt, who brought them across the sea, who led them through the wilderness. And now Moses is gone. He went for a walk and never came back. And God speaks to Joshua and tells him, Moses, my servant, is dead. And God doesn't give him any time to mourn. God doesn't give him any time to process the news. God just says, get up, it's time to go. He says, only be strong and very courageous. And then he begins to tell him how to do that. He said, keep the word in front of you. Don't turn to the right or to the left. Keep it in front of you. He said, then you will be careful to do it, and then you'll have good success wherever you go. You see, if you don't, everybody wants success wherever they go. But not everybody wants to be a doer of the word, and not everybody wants to keep the word in front of them all the time. Why is that? Because that takes work. That takes discipline. That's a lot harder thing than to just say, hey, let's go out and be successful. But he said, keep it in front of you. Because if you keep it in front of you, then you'll be careful to do it. Implying that if you don't keep it in front of you, you won't be careful to do it. You might do it sometimes, you might not other times. But if you keep it in front of you, then you'll be careful to do it. And if you're careful to do it, then you'll have success wherever you go. Amen. James said something very similar. James said, the doer of the word will be blessed in what he does. He didn't say the believer of the word. He said the doer. The doer of the word will be blessed in what he does. So, what does the Bible tell us to do? It tells us to fight the good fight of faith. What is faith? Faith is based on the Word of God. Faith is not just a positive, optimistic outlook. You know, the world uses faith very differently than the Bible uses faith. The world says it's just, you know, it's just going to be all right. Well, why is it going to be all right? I don't know, but it's just going to be all right. Faith says it's going to be all right, and when asked why it's going to be all right, it says, because God told me right here that he would be with me in trouble, that he would never leave me nor forsake me, that he would see me through, he would guide me, he would protect me, he would help me, and that's why it's going to be all right. Amen. Amen. Because faith is based on the will of God. It's based on the Word of God. It's not just based on a feeling or a hope. It's based on something concrete. It's based on something substantial. So he said, here, fight the good fight of faith. Then he said, take hold of the eternal life to which you were called. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called. God has called you to eternal life. And that eternal life is not just about heaven somewhere down the line. whether we live out our days and move on to heaven or Jesus comes back, it's not just about heaven. But taking hold of eternal life is about what we do today. Because see, here's the thing about eternity. Eternity doesn't start when you get to heaven. Eternity has already begun. We're living in it now. And he said, take hold of the eternal life to which you were called. He wasn't talking to someone who was on this. I mean, Paul's not talking to somebody who's on their deathbed, right? I mean, he's not talking to somebody who's laying in a hospital bed dying, saying, hey, hold on, brother, heaven's going to be a wonderful place. He's talking to a young man who's in the midst of doing what God's called for his life. And he said, take hold of eternal life. Because there's things to be laid hold of now. In another place, Paul was talking about, he was actually talking about people who had gone astray and a bunch of, gotten off in some areas and backslidden. And he said this, he said, but I'm convinced of better things concerning you. Things that accompany salvation. You know, there's things that accompany salvation. Eternal life isn't just about salvation. There's things that go along with being saved. There's things that belong to you because you are saved. There's things that belong to you. They're yours, but you have to contend for them. Because like I said at the beginning, you've got the enemy, the devil, and his crowd, his system. It's all set up to steal, kill, and destroy. It's set up to rob you of what God wants for you. But Jesus, on the other hand, has something better for you. So who's going to prevail? Which plan is going to work in your life? Which plan is going to, I mean, how do you decide that? Well, are you going to believe what God said and fight for it? Or do you just surrender and just go with the flow? Well, God said, fight for it. Lay hold of eternal life to which you were called. Fight for what belongs to you because God has good things in store for you. Hold your place here and go over to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4, it says, for whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. Whatever is born of God overcomes the world. As a believer, you already have everything you need to succeed, and it's resident within you, in the person of the Holy Spirit. The life of God on the inside of you has within it everything you need to be victorious, to overcome. Because when you were recreated, when you were born again, you were created in God's image. Amen. And everything necessary for victory is there. But you don't know it's there unless you read the Bible. You don't know what God has done for you unless you know what your Bible says. The scriptures, like we were talking about earlier, the key. That key, there are keys that unlock certain things. There are keys that give you access to certain things. You can cruise along at one speed, at one level, but then you find that there's another key and you can go up a level. There's things that belong to you. There's things that God wants you to have that aren't automatic in your life. And this goes along with the whole belief that, well, God is in control. There's a lot of people that believe that if something is the will of God, then it's just going to happen. It's going to be automatic in your life. And it's just not true. The will of God is not automatic in your life. If that was the case, I mean, we'd have seen a massive revival long before now, because the Bible says God is not willing that any should perish. But, you know, people are perishing daily. Right? So the will of God is not automatic. It has to be received. It has to be believed. It has to be acted on. We have to do something with it. in order for it to be real in our lives. And so we have to fight the good fight of faith. We have to hold on to those things that the Bible says. And sometimes what the Bible says and what your experience says are not just different, but they almost seem incompatible. You ever had that experience? Where you're living one thing and the Bible says you can have something and that Jesus has provided something entirely different? Which way are we going? Which plan is going to prevail? The one that we believe and align ourselves with. And see, this is one of the reasons why confession is so important. Confession is an outflow of our faith. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13, Paul said, "We believe, therefore we speak." The speaking is an outflow of our faith. Which plan is going to prevail? The one that we align our heart and our mouth to. Because Jesus said, you'll have what you say. Mark chapter 11, right, verse 23, he said, you'll have what you say. Well, is that true? That you'll have what you say? Well, Jesus said it. I have to believe that he knew what he was talking about. If you're going to have what you say, then why do we say some of the things that we say? If we really believed that we were going to have what we say, why in the world would we say some of those things? But we do it all the time. Right? We allow the frustrations and the problems and the things that we're dealing with to get in our heart and get in our mouth, and then we give voice to them, and without realizing it, we're perpetuating those very things. And we get frustrated, and we say it, and then we get more of it. Right? But Jesus said, you'll have what you say. When I was in high school, I bought a car. It was a 1976 Trans Am. And it was beautiful. It was black, had the gold Firebird on the hood, had gold Krager wheels. It was something. It was fast. And I bought that car, and the first time I showed up, my friends looked at that and they went, "Oh man, that is bad." Because that was the word back then. That is bad. They all said my car was bad. I said my car was bad. And you know what?
It was.
That car ended up being bad. I blew up two engines and a transmission. Twice had somebody run into it in a parking lot, put big dents in it, and just drive away. I was parked at the mall, and some guys got into a fight right in front of my car. They didn't do anything, but the friends of one of the guys that was fighting, trying to get to his friend to help him, jumped up on my car, ran the length of it, and jumped off the front of it and put dents in it all the way, with every step. I ended up selling that car for $700, and I was glad to get it. Because it was bad. But nobody had ever taught me these things. I had no idea that my words made a difference. I had no idea that I could have what I say. I grew up in church, but they didn't teach us this. But then I started to learn some things. I started to find out some things. Years later, I had another car. It was a 1993 Jeep Cherokee. And I liked that car. It was all right. But I learned some things in the meantime, and when I bought that car, I prayed over it. And then when I would get in the car, I didn't really do this in front of people, but I'd get in the car by myself, and I'd put my hand on the dash, and I'd go, "You're a good car. You're reliable. You're faithful. You always get me where I need to go, and you never leave me stranded." And man, I talked nice to that car. I finally sold the car, and when I sold it, it had 219,000 miles on it and was still running strong, and there was really nothing wrong with it. And the whole time I owned it, I put a new set of tires on it, I changed a battery, but nothing ever broke. Well, one thing broke, an idler pulley broke. And I went to the auto parts store, got a new one, and I spent a whole $7. Replaced that in about 10 minutes. And I was going again. And other than that, I didn't spend any money on that thing. And I remember talking to somebody who knew cars, who bought and sold cars, and they said, they were just shaking their head at me and that car, and they said only you could have gotten 200 and something thousand miles out of that car. And I said, well, I mean, I did what the Bible said to do. But I learned some things that you have to release your faith. You have to use your faith. You have to believe God for the things that God says are yours. Amen. You have to fight for those things. It's all in you. It's all there. But if you don't unlock it, if you don't give voice to it, if you don't activate it, it's not going to work. Amen. So, whatever is born of God overcomes the world. Amen. You know, go to Philippians chapter 4. I wasn't going to go here, but this fits. Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4, in verse 11, well, I'll read verse 10 and then verse 11. He says, "But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at last you've revived your concern for me. And indeed you were concerned before, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak from want, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. I know how to get along with humble means, and I also know how to live in prosperity. In any and every circumstance, I've learned the secret of being filled and going hungry, both of having an abundance and suffering need. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me." Now, this is a very different statement. This is a declaration of faith from Paul. He says, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Now, this is the same Paul that previously was crying out to the Lord, saying, "I can't take this anymore." Remember, he said there was given me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan sent to buffet me and keep me from going beyond the usual mark. That thorn in the flesh, theologians and scholars have argued and I mean, just discussed and worked all the way around it, but that tried to make it some kind of sickness or disease or some kind of ailment that Paul was dealing with. It wasn't any of those things. He told us what it was. He said it was a messenger of Satan sent to buffet him. What does buffet mean? It means to knock him around. Beat him around. Just abuse him. He said a messenger of Satan was sent to buffet me just to give me trouble and keep me from going beyond the usual mark. Well, Paul was blind. He had eye disease. He didn't have any of those things. He had a demon on assignment to him that was stirring up all kinds of trouble. And he told us what it was. In the chapter just before, is I think it's 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Let me just flip over here real quick. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He's in verse 7. He's talking about the thorn of the flesh. But at the end of chapter 11, he tells us what that thorn of the flesh was. He said he's defending his apostleship and his ministry, but he says at the middle of verse 23, chapter 11, he said, in far more labors, in far more imprisonments, beaten times without number, often in danger of death. 5 times I received from the Jews 39 lashes. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I've spent in the deep. I've been on frequent journeys in dangers from rivers, dangers from robbers, dangers from countrymen, dangers from the Gentiles, dangers in the city, dangers in the wilderness, dangers in the sea, dangers among false brethren. I've been in labor and hardship through many sleepless nights, in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold and exposure. Apart from such external things, there's the daily pressure on me concerning all of the churches. So he tells us what that thorn in the flesh was. That was an enemy working against him. I mean, Paul had it rough. I mean, beaten that many times, shipwrecked that many times. I mean, imprisoned and just abused. And you read through the account of Paul's life and ministry, and you see that he had a band of people that followed him everywhere he went, inciting riots against him. They beat him and left him for dead at one point. And I mean, he went through some trouble and some difficulty. So then in chapter 12, when he cries out to the Lord and he says, Lord, take this from me, remove this from me, that's what he's talking about. He's talking about there's an enemy working against me and I can't take it anymore. I need you to remove it from me. And 3 times he cried out to the Lord, and 3 times the Lord responded with, my grace is sufficient for you. Now, what has happened is that people have taken that response from Jesus that says, my grace is sufficient for you, and they've said, see, I mean, you just got to tough it out. Just make the best of a bad situation. Just be strong as you can, and just make the best of it. Just power on. And that wasn't what Jesus was saying at all. Because when Jesus says, my grace is sufficient for you, what is grace? Grace is the sum total of everything that Jesus did for us in redemption. What Jesus was saying to him was not, well, just hold on, brother. It'll be all right eventually. You'll get there. No, what Jesus was saying was, what I did for you in redemption, my grace, what I accomplished for you is enough. So Paul had to dig into the Word and dig into what belongs to him and find out, what is it that Jesus did for me? It's enough. And so from 2 Corinthians chapter 12 to Philippians chapter 4, Paul has a complete attitude and outlook change. In 2 Corinthians 12, he's saying, Jesus, help me. You got to do something about this. And in Philippians chapter 4, Paul is saying, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But you can put me in any kind of circumstance. You can put me in deep need. You can put me in abundance, and I know what to do. If there's not enough, I know how to get out of that. If you give me enough, and if you give me abundance, you give me more than enough, I know what to do with it. I've learned the secret of living, one translation says. I've learned the secret of living, and I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. No, see, there's no more begging and pleading with God. Oh, God, help. No, it's, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Your faith is going to be challenged. It's going to be challenged. But how are you going to respond to that challenge? A lot of people look to heaven and go, oh, God, help. Please do something. And the problem with that is that where our redemption is concerned, he's done all he's going to do. It's already done. Can you see how foolish it is to ask God to do something that he's already done? It's pointless. That was the lesson of 2 Corinthians 12. Paul's asking God to do something that he's already done. My grace is sufficient for you is Jesus saying to Paul, already done. Open your eyes. Look at your Bible. I mean, he's looking at Paul saying, you're gonna have to open your eyes a little bit here and see that you're asking me to do something I've already done. And Paul's attitude changed. Philippians chapter 4, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That is a bold statement from a man who knows who he is in Christ and knows what's been provided for him. Put me in any kind of circumstances. It doesn't matter. The circumstance doesn't define me. See, too many times we let circumstances define us. Yeah, but you don't know what I've been through. It doesn't matter what you've been through. See, the truth is, when you came to Jesus, Jesus didn't just give you a new future. He didn't just cut you off from a future that was going to hell and give you heaven in its place. He also cut you off from your past. Old things, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creature, and old things are passed away, and all things have become new. He cuts you off from your past, so when he looks at you, he doesn't see your past and your mistakes and your failures and all the things that you got wrong. When he looks at your past, what he sees is Jesus' substitutionary work. He sees Jesus on a cross dying for you. He sees Jesus coming out of a tomb risen for you. He sees Jesus seated at the right, at his own right hand, making petition for you, advocating for you. He didn't just give you a new future, he gave you a new past. Amen. And see, we have to come to see ourselves the way that God sees us. And only the Bible can do that. No amount of counseling, no amount of self-help books and seminars, no amount of positive thinking can do that. Only the Bible can show you who you are in Christ Jesus. And what the Bible says is that if you were in Christ Jesus, then you are an overcomer. You are more than a conqueror. Amen. This is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. Our faith in what? Not our faith in ourselves, not our faith in just a positive overall outlook, our faith in the Word of God and what God says to us and what God says about us. That faith will overcome the world. That faith will overcome everything that we've been through, everything that's been thrown at us. Because who hasn't had a bad time of it? We like to think that, well, we're the only ones. No, you're not the only one. There are plenty of people that have been through the exact same things you're dealing with. You're not the only one, but God has a path to victory for you. Amen. You can't control what other people do, but you can determine where you're going to go from here. And a choice to believe and act on the Word of God will set you on a path to victory. Amen. A decision to believe what the Word says about you will set you on a path to victory. And that's what God wants for you. He said, I have a good plan for you. It's a plan for a future and for a hope. Amen. Your faith is going to be tested, but how you respond is everything. That's why the Bible encourages us to hold on to our faith, hold on to our confession, hold on to those things. Amen. Because how you respond is everything. What happens to you is not nearly as powerful a thing in your life as how you respond to it. Because it's inevitable that trials are going to come. I mean, the Bible tells us that. I think one of the great disservices that Christians do in presenting the gospel is to tell people that, well, if you'll just give your life to the Lord, all your troubles will go away. Everything will be good. No, you give your life to the Lord, your troubles are just getting started. But the difference is, now there's a path to victory. Now you have help. God is on your side. God will see you through. It's not over yet. Amen. It's not over. Amen. Because see, the devil will come after you, and he'll just... Nah, 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 nah. Sometimes you have to shut him up. Can I tell you a real quick story? It's real, real quick. When I was a kid, I lived in Venezuela for a couple of years, and down the street was another American kid, and he was one of those just mouthy, obnoxious kind. And one day he came out. We were walking down the street, and he came out into his yard, and he just started yelling at us with no provocation. Just started yelling and cursing at us, and just it was just obnoxious, you know. So we were like, what's going on with that? You know, just we tried to ignore him, and he kept at it, and after a minute of that, one of my younger brothers had enough, and where we lived was on the edge of town, and there was desert right behind our neighborhood, and at night donkeys and goats and cattle would come out grazing the yards and then go back into the desert, and so it wasn't uncommon for there to be droppings here and there. This kid comes out, he's mouthing, and Russell, my younger brother, had enough. He reached down and picked up some donkey poop, and he just let it fly. And I was like, I mean, when you're a kid, that's like the perfect throwing size. He hit that kid right in the mouth. It was beautiful. Right in the, I mean, and he's like, bam, right in his mouth. All of a sudden, he starts spitting and gagging. And he turned around and ran back into the house. Yeah, I'm sure he washed his own mouth out with soap. I said all that because sometimes you gotta put a stop to the. There's stuff that just going. And the devil wants to keep you agitated and provoked because he wants to get you off balance and keep you off of your place of faith. Because if he can get you in the flesh, then you respond in the flesh. You respond outside of faith. And sometimes you just got to shut him down. And you shut him down by hitting him with what he likes the least. And what he likes the least is the word of God in your mouth. You hit him with that, and he will stop. Amen. I can't tell you how many times I've had people tell me things like, well, I've been dealing with these thoughts and these things, and it just, you know, I can't get past this. You can put a stop to it. You don't have to put up with that. Amen. The devil can't just come into your life and do whatever he wants to do. He can't just come into your life and just torment you. Not if you won't stand for it. The reason people stand for it is because they don't think that they have any options. Your option is to put the word of God in your mouth. Tell the devil, no, you don't. You're not doing that to me. Sometimes you've got to tell him, enough. Be quiet. You know, in a number of Jesus' encounters with demon-possessed people, very often the first thing he said was, shut your mouth. I'm not here for you. I'm not here to listen to you run your mouth. So you can just shut it. Amen. And you have that authority in your own life. You are not a victim. Amen. You are not powerless. You're not helpless and you're not hopeless. But God is on your side. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Victory is yours when you do things God's way. Thank God for that. Just stand up with me and just thank God for victory. There's a path of victory laid out before you. The path of victory is found in what God says to you, what God's word says to you. Just lift your hands and just thank God for a path to victory. Lord, we thank you. We thank you tonight. We honor you. We give you praise. We thank you, Lord, for the victory that is ours. We thank you, Lord, that we have what it takes to conquer and to overcome because Jesus won that for us. Jesus is our champion, and he won the victory for us. Jesus' victory is our victory when we stand on the word. Lord, we honor you tonight, and we thank you and give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God is good. God is good. Amen. All right. Wasn't sure where we were going from here, but praise the Lord. God is good. Hallelujah. He's faithful. Amen. Let me pray for you, and we'll be done for tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word, and I thank you for your faithfulness to your word and to your people. And Father, I pray for each person here tonight and each family represented here. And Father, I pray according to your word that you would be with them, that you would bless them, that you would lead and guide them, that you would protect them. Father, and I thank you for it. I thank you that your word says it is you who blesses the righteous man, O Lord. You surround him with favor as with a shield. And I thank you, Father, that goodness and mercy follow after us all the days of our lives. And we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen.